Yeah, the one thing he has been in the day last yesterday. I guess he probably wants to go into the bank for that.
Okay. All good.
All right. So, welcome everyone. The last week of the Dispersive hydrodynamics program. Very happy that today we have Davide from University of East Anglia talking about Stokes drift and impurity transport of quantum fluid. Please.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Thanks for inviting me to give this talk in the last week of this program, beautiful program. So I should probably say that I was hoping to talk about something different because, with good excitement, I started some new work in October when I started joining the program. And I was really hoping to get some partial results, but of course, I mean, normally our hopes fade miserably. And so I'm going to talk about this other topic that is a work that has been done mainly by Umberto Giuriato during his PhD studies. That is, I would say, 3 or 4 years ago already. So Umberto has already finished his PhD, had his viva, and he moved to industry. And somehow we all these results were left there. So we worked mainly this summer, George Kusulovic, myself, and Miguel Lorato to try to collect all these results and eventually write a paper that we hope to submit soon. So soon is going to be on the archive and be submitted. Right. So this talk is going to be about Stokes drift. So I'm going to give a very, very quick recap on Stokes drift in classical fluids, really, really quickly. And I expect that probably most of you know more than me about Stokes drift in a classical fluid. And then I'm going to tell you more about the analog of the Stokes drift in a quantum fluid. And in order to do that, I'm going to use the Gross-Piteaveskii model. Again, maybe some of you know about this model, but for those of you who do not know, I'm going to recap the model and how you can put impurities or particles into this model. And then I'm going to tell you a bit more about the results that we got, which are formally obtained by doing some numerical simulations and theoretical prediction in two dimensions. But I guess that you can easily extend these to three dimensions. Right. So if you don't know anything about Stokes drift, like myself, a couple, maybe 5 years ago, you maybe want to Google Stokes drift and go on Wikipedia. And these are two things that you can get from Wikipedia. So the first one is the definition, in a loose sense, that says the Stokes drift velocity is the average velocity when following a specific fluid parcel as it travels with the fluid flow.
That could mean so many different things.
Yeah, okay, so.
Or is that maybe your point?
Yes. So it's very general, and you're completely right. And then you can see this picture here, which is not exactly the same thing as of the definition, because of course here we're not really talking about fluid parcels. I mean, there are huge logs of wood, but somehow Stokes drift, well, transport of these external objects is a consequence of, let's say, the Stokes drift. Or in some sense, you can use the same Stokes drift derivation that you do for a fluid particle to also study the transport of external objects which are immersed in a fluid.
But there's a difference between a massless particle and a mass particle.
Absolutely. Yes. So you need to be careful, of course. Okay. Now, I think that the original work of Stokes was done in 1847. In this paper here, which are transactions of the Cambridge Philosophical Society, I couldn't find this work online, but maybe one can find the original work here in Cambridge. So I should look for that. But I found a nice paper by Longit Higgins citing this work and giving a lot of information and in addition to these original works by Stokes. And I think that Stokes first derived obtained this result when studying surface gravity waves. And again, here I can play this nice video. And I also got it from the Wikipedia page of Wikipedia. So this is what you find when you're looking at the displacement of fluid particle subject to surface gravity waves. Okay. So in first approximation, if you look at if you have any wave, any surface gravity wave between let's say water and air, you solve the Laplace equation, you compute dispersion relation, and so on. So in first approximation, you can then study the motion of the fluid parcel, and you can find out that the motion is completely elliptical. Okay, so there is no effective transport in the first approximation at the first order. And then in particular, depending on if you are in deep water waves or in shallow water waves, in deep water waves, you have that the trajectory are perfect circles. If you are in the shallow water waves, the trajectory are very long ellipses. But then at the second order, if you go up to the second order, you find out that actually these fluid particles, they also travel a bit, they also drift a bit. And this is exactly what the Stokes drift is about. So at the second order, these trajectory are not completely closed and they move, let's say, following the direction of the incoming wave. So in this case, it's from left to right. Okay. And in particular, you can work out what is these mean velocity, mean drift. And by doing some, for example, multiple time scale expansion in the problem. And this is one of the known results. So for a sinusoidal wave of this type with amplitude A, dispersion relation omega and with number K, this is the effective drift that you get. So your drift depends on omega and K on the amplitude of the wave squared. And then there is this factor here that depends on the depth. So here is that is the fluid depth. Of course, the displacement is a larger at the interface compared to the bottom for a deep gravity waves. For shallow gravity waves, you also have a huge displacement at the bottom. This factor. Okay. Right. So this is what we know from Stokes' drift in this context. Of course, you can apply the Stokes drift idea to any flow, and then you can also ask yourself the question, as Tom was pointing out, what happens if you have don't really want to follow a fluid particle itself, but if you want to follow an external particle that is immersed into the fluid, and so the idea is that you need to work out what is the equation of motion for, let's say, the fluid particle, or in this case, the acceleration of the fluid particle Q. So you need a model that tells you how the acceleration or velocity of the fluid particle Q is related to the velocity of the fluid U. Okay, and this model it's really a model that you have to postulate in some sense, because that depends on many factors. It depends on the viscosity of the fluid, on the size of the particle, on the time scales of the problem. On the buoyancy of the density of the ratio between the density of the particle and the density of the fluid, on the shape. So it varies a lot, and it's a difficult problem.
Excuse me, Q is the coordinate of the external particle? Q?
Yes, Q is the position of the particle. So for example, here I've even simplified the problem, because I'm assuming, let's say, a particle that can be described only through its position. So I'm effectively assuming that the particle is a kind of point-like particle, so it has a. But maybe you could even add, you know, other degrees of freedom, like the rotation of the particle, momentum of inertia, and those kind of things, I guess, right? As I said, I'm really not an expert on this topic, but I think that this is probably the most general case that you can consider somehow. And F is a function on it that depends on the system that you are considering. So yes, Q is the acceleration of, or Q is the position of the particle, and U is the velocity of the fluid. And then, for example, you could say, well, if you have perfect tracers, so what are perfect tracers? Well, there are small particles that they have the same density of the density of the fluid parcels, and because they are so small, somehow what you expect is that the fluid motion at that scale is laminar. And so if you assume an infinite Stokes drag, so let's say that the fluid is able to transport this particle following exactly the velocity of the fluid itself, then these are perfect tracers. But this is not always the case, because maybe you're not in this regime. And so also other inertial effects and buoyancy needs to be considered. So it's a complicated problem. Okay. But what I want to say is that normally these problems here, well, in this problem, viscosity plays a crucial role, let's say. So, so the idea of trying to find the analog of Stokes drift in a quantum fluid, which is a purely inviscid fluid, somehow originated due to these events that took place in 2019. It was called Stokes 200, and it was to celebrate the bicentenary of the Stokes birth, and that happened here in Cambridge. I didn't take part to the event, but when we saw the event, we actually started asking ourselves the question, oh, what about Stokes drift in a quantum fluid? What about Stokes drag and so on? And so all the ideas somehow originated thanks to this event. And the two main questions that we ask ourselves were, is there an analogous of Stokes drift in a quantum fluid? That is the type of fluid, the quantum fluid that we had in mind is purely inviscid and compressible. And if so, how does this affect the transport of particles? Now, particles in a quantum fluid normally are called impurities. So that's why I'm going to use the word impurities for particles. But the idea is that there are external objects that are transported in this quantum fluid. Right. So what is the model of the quantum fluid that we use? So we use probably the simplest type of model, mean field model that you can consider in a quantum fluid if you're working to model, for example, Bose-Einstein condensate. So we're not modeling superfluid liquid helium, but if you think about Bose-Einstein condensate or quantum fluid applied, the Gross-Piteaveskii model is the up to my knowledge is the simplest model that you can consider. There's a nonlinear PE. And effectively is a nonlinear Schrodinger type of equation. So psi here is a complex function that is the order parameter of the quantum fluid. And you have, let's say, a time derivative, and then you have a kinetic term, and then you have your nonlinearity that is an effective nonlinearity that includes the interaction of all the bosons that they make up these quantum fluid. And then you can even add some external potential that is coupled to your quantum fluid. So in our case, the impurities are going to, let's say, couple to the quantum fluid through this external potential term. So just for those of you that are not expert on this model, so this is a really good model for Bose-Einstein condensates. Modeling dilute cold atomic gases. You can actually derive this model in a perturbative way from the quantum made by the Hamiltonian of the system. in the limit of zero temperature. And this G here can depends on the atomic species that you consider. But it's also a qualitatively good model for other type of superfluids, or quantum fluids like liquid helium, even though it's not exactly can kind of tell you quantitative predictions, because this is valid for a dilute system, a compressible dilute system. Yes, and right. So you can take this nonlinear PDE and you can rewrite it in a more a traditional framework if you are a mechanicist. So you make what is called the Malebranche transformation. So you rewrite this complex wave function into the square root of rho, that is going to be your density. That should be over m if you consider the mass. And then times the exponential of I phase field. So you write your complex function in terms of two real functions, rho and phi. And then if you call something proportional to the gradient of phi, a velocity field, then this equation here can be split into its imaginary and real part, and you obtain these two coupled equations. So this is nothing but the continuity equation for compressible flow fluid, and this is nothing but let's say the order type of equation for the same fluid, or let's say the equation for the conservation of linear momentum. And at the right hand side you have your forcing terms, so you have some kind of pressure term in here, which is like a traditional pressure terms where the telling you that the fluid is barotropic, so the pressure state only depends on the density. You have this extra term here that is called quantum pressure, that is really just peculiar to this model here, but it's only important at very small scales. So you can sort of forget it if you're looking at large scales in the system. And then you have also the present the term that is proportional to your external potential that could act as a forcing term. But you can notice that there is no Laplacian in here, so this should convince you that this is a good model for an inviscid fluid. So there is no viscosity. Okay. Yeah. Right. So these equation here has two nonlinear limits, weak nonlinear limits. If you want to think in that way, so you can either have, let's say, a type of solution where you have the system that has many waves, it is a superposition of waves, okay, but there is not a mean field a mean average value of your order parameter. So in other words, the average value of psi, or let's say the absolute value of psi, is zero. Okay, so this is what is called the Brody limit, and effectively in this limit the kinetic term is dominant compared to the nonlinear term. Okay, so it's just, let's say, a soup of weakly nonlinearly interacting waves. So there is no concept of density here, and the dispersion relation is effectively just coming from the first term in your equation. But then there is the opposite limit, which is sometimes it's called the Bogoliubov limit, which is characterized by, let's say, a non-zero uniform value of the density of the fluid, and then you only have small perturbation of this. So you have a little, let's say, density phase perturbation over this constant density field. And you can work out what is the dispersion relation for this type of perturbation. This is the dispersion relation here. It's called the Bogoliubov dispersion relation. And this is interesting because instead of having some quadratic dispersion relation in K, you have something that can be either quadratic in one limit and acoustic, so linear, in another limit. So for very short waves, the dispersion relation is still quadratic, so this term wins. So you've got something that is proportional to k squared. Okay, But if your case, sorry, waves are really, really long, this term is instant negligible, and this term is win. This rho zero is proportional to the, this rho zero is the mean value of the density. Okay. And so you have something, some dispersion relation that is like acoustic like. So you have an effective speed of sound. So waves, large wave, they do move with the same speed, which is the speed of sound here. And the transition between, let's say, these two regimes occurs at what is called the healing length. So at this case, which are larger than this healing length, you have acoustic and acoustic regimes, as at this case smaller than this healing length, you have effectively a free particle regime.
Should that be k
squared? Where? Here. Oh, yes, there should be a k squared. Correct. Sorry. Thanks for that. Absolutely. Yes, so that you can recover this limit when this is negligible. Yes, thank you, Dan. Okay, so we're interested in this regime here when perturbations are very, very long. So we're effectively in the acoustic regime. Okay, for what comes next. Right. Okay. So this is the model. How do you put particles, impurities, into it? Well, there are several recipes you can do. One of them is to couple classical-like particles to these Gross-Piteaveskii nonlinear Schrödinger equation. So you have the nonlinear Schrödinger equation or Gross-Piteaveskii equation that I've written before. And then instead of considering the external potential, well, you replace this kind of external potential with some effective potential, Vp, that models the particle, the impurity. That is coupled to psi. Okay. In this case here, I'm just citing this model that has been introduced by several authors. So in this slide, I'm considering more than one particle, but after I will only consider one particle. So in this case, in here this term goes from it's a summation. It goes from one to the total number of particle external particle in the system. So this is the coupling between the quantum fluid and the effective potential of the particles, and then each particle moves according to a classical like equation. So you have Newton's second law for the particle. So the mass of the particle times its acceleration. So q dot dot I is the acceleration of the I particle, is given by the coupling with the quantum fluid that stands out from this term here, plus some eventual interaction between the particles. So maybe you can consider some repulsive interaction between particles. But let's forget about it here. So this is the important term. So you have that the force acting on the I particle is proportional to this integral that contains this effective particle potential times the gradient of the mod psi square of psi of the quantum fluid. So this is the gradient of the density. So this is telling you that the force acting on the particle due to the presence of the quantum fluid is proportional to the gradient of density. So in other words, the particle is moved due to density gradients or pressure gradients. Yes.
Why do you choose to write it like that? You could put the gradient from the potential as per usually, and then you have a force sandwiched between a psi. So that there would be no density gradient. It's a matter of choice. No?
Yes. You're right.
So
would that change something?
No, I'm asking. Because you emphasize that the gradient of density matters, actually it depends on your choice.
Okay.
And there one which is more convenient than the other, or
not really. I think I'm just stating the model as it was stated in this paper. So this is how I started looking at this model, and that's why I'm writing. But you're right. I mean, you can always well, by using some assuming some boundary conditions, so you can always change the gradient from here to here. Excuse me.
It would look more like Newton's law.
Okay.
If you put the gradient outside as well.
Okay.
Well, of course, it's still the law, but I mean the usual form gradient.
Okay. Yeah. I will come back in the next slide about this effective potential. But yeah, you're completely right. I mean, you can rewrite this term as you want. I just want to tell you that this model is a, well, you can define a proper Hamiltonian for the model, which is the Hamiltonian of your GP Gross-Piteaveski equation plus the classical Hamiltonian plus the interaction term. The total number of particles into the quantum fluid are conserved, and the momentum is defined as the momentum of the fluid plus the momentum of the particles.
Can you envision what physically, what kind of particles would actually exist in the quantum fluid without destroying it?
Tricky question. So you can think of, for example, if you think about the vacuum, you can think of external particles like electrons, but electrons are more like a wavefront, so maybe they're not like classical like particles, but let's say deuterium deuterium's granular particles. So these are used in experiment to visualize superfluid flow. So they put deuterium particles. They will form aggregates, which are massive aggregates compared to the helium in superfluid helium. And this would be transported by the helium. So these might be particles, but they're really, really massive compared to the helium, which is not the case that we're going to treat here. You can think about, well, electron in superfluid helium. So in the case of electron, maybe the classical light description is not really correct. So you might want to have, let's say, a GD coupled with a linear Schrodinger equation for particle. And this is the same thing that you might want to consider for, let's say, an impurity that could be in a VEC. For example, you could have, let's say, a VEC form of rubidium atoms. And then imagine that you put a potassium atom. I don't know if this is possible, but let's say another species. And the second species is so dilute that maybe you can describe the second species not by a secondary coupled GP-like equation, but just a linear Schrodinger equation for that particle. But again, here we're treating the particle classically, just to simplify things. Because if you treat the particle as a wave function, then things are a bit more complicated. I'm not saying that they're not interesting at all, but I don't think that we would be able to do the same type of analysis. The third example could be obstacles in quantum fluid of light. So these could be seen as suppose that obstacles can move, okay, and the obstacle size might be of the range of the helium. This could be some classical like particles immersed in a quantum fluid. Yes. Okay. So,
how am I doing with time?
Good. Right. So, for topic of this talk, I'm going to consider only one impurity. So the the system simplifies a bit because we have our GP equation coupled with a single impurity here. So the effective potential of the impurity depends on the it's normally an effective potential depends on the distance between the center of mass of the impurity, which is at position Q. X is the coordinate of the field side, and then we have a single particle. So we have a single Newton's law for this impurity here. There is no impurity interaction. Okay, and what we imagine is an impurity which is a size comparable with the Hilbert length. So this is definitely a strong choice and will not apply for liquid helium, as I was saying, because liquid helium, I mean, the size of the impurity is maybe 10 to the 4 times the helium length, or even more. Right, and then what we're gonna assume is that we're gonna have only Bogoliubov type of waves into these quantum fluid, and we're only looking at large waves compared to the helium length. So in the fluid dynamical description, we can write this wave density and velocity of the fluid in terms of let's say density variation. So rho zero is the uniform density plus some sinusoidal variation with amplitude a rho, and velocity of the fluid follows follow this form given this density variations. Okay, so we're going to do our analysis on these based on this assumption and based on these force here. Okay, now I'm skipping a bit of the details in the following slides about the assumption, but I just want to give you the main ideas. Okay, so what is the effective potential of the impurity that we consider? Well, we want to have, let's say, an impurity which is localized, a bit like, let's say, a spherical particle, okay? So we choose the form of this effective potential as a something that is proportional to the hyperbolic tangent. So let's say it's zero, and then it goes up to one. And we can play with the size of the impurity by playing with the coefficient of the hyperbolic tangent. We can set the effective size of the impurity, well, by playing with that, and if we set it equal to AP, what we find out is that due to the helium length, so let's say there is a helium layer where the quantum fluid recovers its bulk value, which is order of the helium length itself. So this means that effectively the size of the impurity is not really the size that we set thanks to this potential equal to AP, but it's a bit larger. So let's say it's AP bar, okay, taking into consideration also this helium layer. And how do we define this AP bar? Well, it's estimated by measuring the volume of the fluid that is displaced by the impurity. Okay, so what do I mean? So this calculation is done in two dimensions. So this is the volume of a circle, pi minus let's say the radius squared, and so the area of a circle. And this is obtained by looking at the density of the fluid displaced, where psi zero is the uniform density of the system without the impurity, and psi p is the density of the system with impurity that is initially steady. Okay, so this is a measure of the fluid displaced by the impurity, and hence, thanks to that, we can infer what is AP bar. And in this plot here, you can see that if we set AP, well, following this one, just set AP like that, then AP bar is a bit larger. Right, so thanks to that, we can also have a non-dimensional quantity representing the mass of the impurity, M, which is the initial mass of the impurity divided by M0, where M0 is the mass of the fluid displaced. And in our simulations, well, we set V0, which is, let's say, the intensity of this potential, 20 times the chemical potential of the fluid. So the potential is really, really strong. So it's able to push away the superfluid. So in other words, inside the impurity, there is no quantum fluid at all, because this is, well, 20 times higher than the chemical potential of the superfluid. And these are the values that we set in order to have, in the end, a final characteristic radius of the impurity, which is order of 3 helium length. This parameter are just chosen because we were really interested in what happens to an impurity that has this size, not because we had in mind a particular experiment. Okay. Right. So let me show you what happens if you numerically solve the system with this impurity. So what you see here at time t0 is this impurity in green, and then what I'm showing with the colors from light blue to dark blue is the density of the quantum fluid. So there is a density wave in here hitting the impurity that is initially steady. So we prepare our initial system by putting, let's say, the impurity steady plus superimposed with these density wave. Okay, what you can see here, so here there is the density wave going from left to right, and this is just let's say a zoom of the computational domain that is way bigger. Okay, so you see that little by little the impurity affects the density shape of the quantum fluid, and it's drifted from left to right with some velocity. Okay. But in this case, we put the impurity that was sitting at the trough of the density of the wave. Now, if we put the impurity that is initially sitting at the crest,
you're sending a plane wave. I don't know if this is what you do.
Yes. It's not exactly that, because we're not really sending packets. We are putting our impurity initially steady, superimposed with density wave. A sinusoidal density wave that is already everywhere in the system. We're not doing the impurity that is steady and then we're sending a wave packet. So it's not.
And but the density oscillations are progressive oscillations. I mean, it's not a stable.
What we are putting as the density of the field in this initial condition. So there is a uniform density plus some sinusoidal wave. So it's not a wave packet in that sense.
I mean, it's not a stationary wave. It's a progressive wave.
It's a progressive wave. Yeah. Sorry. It's a progressive wave going from left to the right. Yes, it's not a standing wave. Sorry. Yes. I thought that you meant that you were asking if it was a wave packet, so let's say decaying at infinity, but no, it's defined everywhere. Okay, so in this case it's moving from left to right, always moving from left to right. Okay, now if the particle stay if the impurity is initially at the trough of this density wave, it will move from left to right. If it is at the crest, even if the wave is moving from left to right, it moves backwards, so in the opposite direction of the wave of the incoming wave. And so the dynamics at these time scales, so here the time is a rescaled with the period of the density wave. Okay, and the wave is very, very long, right, compared to the size of the impurity. So the dynamics the direction of the motion of the impurity depends on the initial impurity wave phase, so if they are in phase or out of phase. Okay, and this is the sketch of what we get. So if this is the density wave, okay, and the impurity sits initially steady at the top of this density wave, so in the low region of density, okay, then the impurity is moving in the same direction of the incoming wave. If it is at the top, so it moves in the opposite direction. And in the end, it's not something unexpected, because the impurity will always move in the direction of lower pressure. And so in this case, because the wave is moving from left to right, at the next step, the lower pressure area is going to be somehow here, right? So it makes sense that the impurity is moving also from left to right. In this case here, the lower pressure area is going to be on the left of the original position. So that's why the impurity moves backwards. Okay. Right. So this is the initial motion of the impurity. But what happens at very long time? Okay, so this is where the derivation of the Stokes drift and transport prediction starts to this is when we started doing some analytical derivation. So starting from the force acting on the impurity, you can do a series of approximations, namely, we assume for simplicity that impurity is defined by a ball of radius at bar, so it's completely spherical. We assume for simplicity in our theoretical derivation, not in the numerical simulation, that the impurity, the particle, is completely passive, so it does not affect the fluid itself. Meaning that, let's say, the density of the fluid is just given by the initial density plus the density of the wave times the ratio between the density of the fluid with the particle divided by the density of the fluid without the particle. And then the assumption for making is that the impurity is small compared to the density phase wave. So in other words, our small parameter is given by k, which is the wave vector of the density wave phase, times ap, let's say the radius of the particle, or ap bar is the same. This needs to be much, much smaller than one. Okay. So if you do this and you do a lot of manipulation of this object here, you find out that a good correction of this force is given by these two terms here. So you have finally your equation that tells you what is the motion, well, what is the acceleration of the particle as a function of the velocity of the fluid itself. So vw is the velocity of the wave in the fluid. There are two terms with two dimensionless parameters that you need to measure experimentally or numerically, because you cannot, at least we were not able to find it from our analytical calculations. And then there is also this coefficient here that depends on the shape of the particles. In this case, it's one or two dimensions. Right, so we fitted these two parameters with a subset of simulations that we carried on. And for the particular size of the impurity that we consider and so on, we will obtain these two values here. So these two parameters are still order one parameters. Okay. So once you know these and you know these parameters, you can actually rewrite this equation in terms of the you know what is the velocity of the wave of the superfluid that is given by that. So you can substitute this in here. Substitute this in here, do some manipulation, and finally you obtain a very simple and shorter relation telling you what is the acceleration of the particle q. Here, this is only in one direction because the wave only propagates along the x direction. So that's why I dropped the vector notation. So the motion of the particle along the x direction, the acceleration of the particle along the x direction is proportional to this factor here, where in here you have the this is dictated by the density of the wave, if you understand. With some parameters that depends on this coefficient and the effective mass. Okay, so we have somehow a prediction, well, of the relation between the equation of the particle and the velocity of the fluid. So then we can do some multiple time scale expansion. So looking at the position of the particle for a very long time. So you take these, you expand these into, well, you do a two time scale expansion. So you consider, let's say, short time t and then long time tau, where tau scales like epsilon times t, and you recast this equation into this new two time scale expansion, and then you go up to the second order and you can average over the fast time scale, and this is what you get. So you get, in the end, you get the, I'm throwing all the details under the carpet, I'm sorry, but because of time, I can show you all the details later on if you're interested. So you find that finally that the velocity of the drift of the particle, which is the velocity of the particle averaged over the short time scale, is given by this expansion here. So you have something that depends on the initial wave impurity wave phase, phi, at the first epsilon order, and then something that depends, well, and a second contribution at the second order. Okay, so let me show you these in the numerical simulations. Right. Okay, so the first coefficient, the sign of the first coefficient, so the direction of the drift of the first coefficient depends on the initial impurity density wave phase. So depending on the phase, so depending if the particle is at the trough or the crest, as I was saying, you might have the particle, let's say, moving in the same direction of the incoming wave, so along the positive along the positive x direction, or backwards along the negative x direction. So this is so in the solid lines, you see the position of the particles at different times for different initial wave phase impurity fluid phases. Okay, and with the dashed lines, you see the prediction coming from these first epsilon terms. So of course, I mean, the prediction is a straight line because when we're making this calculation here, we're averaging over the short time scale. So somehow we're averaging over these oscillations. Okay, and this is another picture. Well, saying that actually the transition from well, this case is rather smooth and it follows very well. Right. So this is just confirming that the first term in the expansion is correct. And then you can verify a bit more this prediction here. So for example, you can change what are we changing here? So in A, we're changing we're considering different wavelengths. So we're verifying the prediction for different wavelengths compared to Tahitian length. So we test this prediction for wavelength which are going from 32 to 256 size of the Tahitian length. In B, we are confirming the prediction for different wave density wave amplitude. And I'll come back to this later on. But you see that, yes, the prediction formally is for really small wave amplitude, 0.01, but it's okay up to 0.06, more or less. In C, we're testing this prediction for different, for impurities with different masses. And then in D, finally, we are testing the second order prediction. So what we are taking the case where the initial position of the particle is such that this first order is identically zero. So phi is what? Phi is pi over two, or and so this contribution should be identically zero so that we can highlight the second order contribution. And so this contribution is lower in time, in this case like epsilon squared, like the classical Stokes drift, and this is what we get for a very long time. And we test this for two different wavelengths. Okay, so this prediction seems to be robust, even if somehow it was obtained in assuming that there is no feedback of the particle on the quantum fluid the particle is perfectly circular and so on. So, right. So summary. Yes. So the first thing to remember is that depending on the initial position, the particle can move actually forward or backward, which is, well, initially for us it was a bit counterintuitive, and then when you understand that the particle wants to move in the region of lower pressure, it's trivial. Second take home message is that we get a really nice and precise theoretical prediction to describe the motion of these impurities, classical like impurities, that seems to be valid after the second order, even in a model where the impurity has some back reaction on the period. But things that are also interested and maybe time for future work. So you can see here, so if this is the initial configuration of the particle sitting in this incoming density wave, you see here that indeed the particle will affect the wave of the superfluid. So the shape of this wave is clearly different from time to time. And then at some point, it seems that the wave will it's unorganized. And it seems that actually some kind of solitary waves appears in the system, which makes sense. The system is nonlinear. So the sinusoidal waves are just valid for very small perturbations. So clearly, I mean, if one would like maybe to have maybe more precise prediction, one should consider really the interaction between the solitary wave, so the nonlinear wave and the impurity itself. And it's particularly visible in here because in this prediction here, we were testing our prediction for different values of the amplitude of the density. And so you can see that for high amplitude of the initial density wave, the prediction, the motion of the particle, the drift, is actually higher, with respect to the theoretical prediction. So in other words, the nonlinear effects becomes important and they seem to drift the particle with higher intensity. Going back to maybe to your question, is this actually something that could be tested in experiment? So probably superfluid, no, because the size of the particle is really, really massive compared to the helium length, which was not the case of our derivation. In dilute BECs, it's not clear. Maybe one would have to study the model where the particles are not classical like particles, but are more like waves. But maybe there is hope to study these in superfluid applied, where you have you can place obstacles, which are classical like obstacles in the superfluid applied, and you can I've just highlighted here one of the paper on this problem. So by putting an obstacle that varies its position compared to time, which in optics is the Z direction, in quantum fields of light, it has been seen that this is like having a particle moving compared to the fluid. There is some density waves which are created due to the motion of this particle. So I wonder if maybe one has some hope to design an experiment which looks a bit like that, where you can maybe hope to study the oscillation of your obstacle due to the Stokes wave drift generated in the quantum fluid of light. Hope so. And with that, I would like to thank Umberto, Giorgio, and Miguel for the science collaboration. Thank you for listening.
So are there any questions? Tom, go ahead, Tom.
Yeah. It sounds like the definition of Stokes drift should include a closed orbit. Like, for example, in the water wave case, you start with a particle path, which is a perfect circle.
Yeah.
And then you add a correction, the Stokes drift is actually the departure from the circle.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that should be confused with particle motion in a fluid. That's a very different concept. I mean, you can have particle motion of all kinds in a fluid. So Stokes drift seems to be intimately connected with some sort of sinusoidal motion. And you seem to hint at that when you got to the end and you said, oh, well, if we have a solitary wave, it's not quite the same. And I think that's the case.
Yes. So, maybe two comments on that. So the Stokes drift, so this closed, but in the first order closed trajectory in the fluid, they should be still present in the quantum fluid itself. So if you just look at the parcel of the quantum fluid, you should see it. I would expect you to due to a density wave, you should see the parcel of this quantum fluid to have some kind of closer trajectories. Then you can ask yourself the question. Okay, you're really dealing with a quantum fluid, so can you really label, a parcel of this quantum fluid in a classical sense? This is a more fundamental philosophical question. Okay, I think that maybe I didn't explain well, but the idea is that we use the same derivation that is done for for the Stokes drift of the fluid parcel itself in order to study then the transport of an external impurity. So it's more like stealing the idea of the derivation, but then applied to a particle immersing the quantum fluid. So we use this idea of multiple scale expansion. So I don't know if I answered your question or not, but yes, but I wouldn't know how to do that for a solid way. So if one has actually tried, even in the classical area, to put a solitary wave rather than a sinusoidal wave and study the solid wave. I have no idea. So do you know if it has been studied?
No.
Okay. Yeah.
So I quite agree with Tom. It's not really the same because in fluid you have particles without interaction with fluid, not just Lagrangian particles. Well, here you have interaction potential. So it's completely different, I would say. Maybe it's quite wrong to say it's Stokes drift. Derivation is like Stokes drift, but situation is completely different.
So we should say more like particle transport.
Yeah, well, particle transport is a whole subject in itself.
Yeah.
And you have chaotic convection based on that. Mm-hmm. Very different subject.
Okay.
Would you come back? I miss what was your passive particle approximation. At some point you said
yes. So what we say is that what we're saying is that the density at any time.
So this is the density of the
VC. Yes, the density of the quantum fluid at any time is just given by the uniform density plus the density of the wave, rescaled by the density of the superfluid with the steady immersed particle. So in other words, this density here is not affected in time by the motion of the particle itself. So there is no back reaction. So the particle is just passive. It just follows this density, and then the equation of motion for this density, you know, is only prescribed by the density of the wave. Does it make sense?
But what else would you need or not encompass the creation of vortices in this description?
I think that the idea is to be really, really far off from velocities which are sufficiently high to create vortices. So you just want the force on the particle to be given by this term here. You don't want any vortex nucleation that will add other forces to the particle. It could be some drag. Because if an object is moving sufficiently fast, then it creates some vortices, then the creation of vortices would create an additional effective force due to the fact that some energy will be spent to create such excitations. So somehow, I mean, the velocity of the fluid should be small compared to the critical velocity in order to avoid this effect. One could consider it, but I would say that's even more complicated.
We actually have a question online. Maybe we'll move on. So Hyder, you want to unmute yourself?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thanks, Davide, for the talk. So I just wanted to ask, did you actually check the results for different size particles? So particles that are small relative to the healing length and large relative to the healing length, just to see a difference, because you said that you don't expect these results to necessarily apply to helium where the healing length is much smaller. I'm just wondering whether there is a difference actually.
Yes. No, we didn't. We didn't do it. So we didn't check that. I think that the idea was really to have a particle which is the size of the healing length, because, well, we simulated all these in a larger box, which is maybe, now I don't remember, maybe it was an order of 100 or 1,000 of a healing length. So if we put the particle that is, let's say, order of 10 or 100 helium lengths, we will have a numerical box which is massive, and we're not entirely sure that we would be able to to solve it. And also because in some of the assumptions that we consider in order to write this force in this approximate way was basically that the our small parameter was that the size of the impurity AP times the incoming wavelength should be really, really small. So yes, maybe this should even work if you consider, if you consider maybe the size larger than the fusion length, you can consider some wavelengths which are even larger. Yes, that could maybe work. You're right, but yes, we haven't done the experiment, the numerical experiments, because they were prohibitive, I think. But it's a good point. Maybe it applies. You're right.
Okay, I think we're about at time, so we thank Davide for that. And we have another seminar tomorrow. Sergey Evgenyuk will be speaking, and then we'll have a little Christmas party afterward to round out the program. I hope you all will come and celebrate and hang out. So,
thank you.
I guess I'm asking the wrong person.
This isn't
well, like.